G'day, my name's Michelle Rodrigues, Aussie dermatologist and founder of Chroma Dermatology, and today we're going to be having a chat about post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation and how that differs from post-inflammatory erythema. So pigmentation doesn't actually mean anything to me. It's kind of just a descriptive term that tells us that someone has more pigment than they should, or potentially less pigment than they should. Pigmentation really needs to be broken up into many different forms. There's hyperpigmentation, which means excess pigment, more melanin in the skin, or hypopigmentation, which means a decreased amount of pigment in the skin. And then there's depigment, or depigmentation, which means a complete absence of pigment in the skin altogether. So hyperpigmentation can be a result of so many different things. There's literally 49 that I can think of causes of facial hyperpigmentation. And each one of these conditions actually has completely separate treatments sometimes. So for some, lasers are great. For others, it's going to make it irreversibly worse. They can all look very, very similar. So it's the first and most important thing with pigmentary disorders is get your diagnosis first by someone who's qualified and can give you that proper diagnosis. Otherwise, you might bark up the wrong tree, spend thousands of dollars potentially on stuff that's never going to work because you didn't have the right diagnosis to begin with. Post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation is the name given to brown discoloration, and it can be light brown, medium tan, or quite dark, that occurs on the skin after inflammation. So this can occur after, say, acne, after psoriasis, after a skin burn, and basically the intensity of the inflammation or the intensity of the acne can actually determine the depth of the pigment, so the color, and the duration, so how long it sticks around after the event. For any kind of post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation, or PIH, we actually try to treat the underlying cause first. So many patients will come and say, hey, I'm really stressed about all the pigment on my face, but when we look carefully, there's actually active acne there. So the most important thing is treat the underlying cause first, and then we can try and fix the hyperpigmentation. Second, it's really important to try to, where possible, use photoprotection, meaning a really good SPF 50 sunscreen that has a high UVA and UVB blocker and visible tint. After you've treated the primary issue and got your sunscreen on board, vitamin B3 or niacinamide, vitamin C, azelaic acid, and retinols or retinoids can be very, very helpful for treating hyperpigmentation. If you are going to work in a vitamin A to your skincare regime, it's probably really important to start with just a few times a week, say a retinol that you get over the counter, mix it with your moisturizer at night and gradually increase the frequency of use. If you are going to use a vitamin B or a vitamin C, they are best used in the morning as your first layer with your sunscreen on top. And of course, if the creams and so forth are not effective, you can actually move to in-clinic treatments. So specifically tailored chemical peels can be helpful, as can certain lasers, and in particular, picosecond lasers are definitely the safest and quickest way of helping hyperpigmentation or post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation specifically. And that differs from post-inflammatory erythema, or PIE, which is a really nifty term that these really smart dermatologists in Boston came up with in 2013, and they invented this term basically to describe the redness that occurs in the skin post acne. And this is most commonly seen in patients with lighter skin types, Caucasian skin types, and Asian skin types. And this again can last from a few months right through to a few years, depending on how severe or how deep-seated the acne is. So again, really important in terms of treatment to treat the acne first and as quickly as you possibly can. Two, sun protect. B, vitamin B3 is actually really important. And of course, you can actually try and utilize topical active ingredients. And interestingly, there's some research to suggest that surface superficial redness can actually be helped with topical tranexamic acid, which is more commonly used in its oral form for melasma. But also you can actually go to in-clinic laser-based treatments. And again, vascular lasers, lasers that target redness, are actually probably the best bet for reducing that post-inflammatory erythema over time. Most people need a good 3 treatments spaced about 8 or so weeks apart to get the best possible results. Don't forget, you can learn more on videos about skin just here. So if you have any comments, questions, queries, just pop them in the comments below. See you next time, guys.